Thanks for joining us here on the fifth day of the Cleveland Humanities Festival on the theme of Remembering War. My name is Peter Knox, and I'm the director of the Baker Nord Center for the Humanities here at Case Western Reserve University, which is sponsoring our lecture today and coordinating the festival. You received comment cards on your way in, and if you'd like to get on our mailing list and hear more about our events, please do fill them out and leave them in the basket up here at up front at the end of the presentation. What we're celebrating in this festival is the unique role of the humanities in informing our conversations on topics of critical public interest, such as war. Within this theme, we have talked about the power of art to heal and perhaps to overcome the uniquely human drive to go to war. The converse of this theme, sadly, is the compelling interest that the forces of war and oppression have in erasing art and memory. The Buddhas of Bamiyan, El Hebei, Palmyra, these are only some of the sites that have been in the news recently, the latest in a depressing ledger of losses to our cultural heritage. How much did the forces of ISIS know about the ancient city when they set the explosives that leveled the 2,000-year-old Temple of Bel in Palmyra? Did they know that it was dedicated to a Mesopotamian god, one of dozens of temples and shrines to the gods of many cults in a city that was not only tolerant of religious diversity, but supported and promoted it? For centuries, Palmyra flourished because of its strategic location on the trade routes to the Red Sea and the Arabian Gulf, bringing goods from India, China, and Southeast Asia to the West. Multicultural and multi-ethnic, Palmyra was home to Greeks, Romans, Parthians, and traders from around the world. The culture of Palmyra was the very antithesis of the dark and malignant ideology that ISIS represents. Did those soldiers who detonated the ancient monuments know any of this, or did they simply see the artistic treasures of a foreign culture as an inherent threat to their terrible mission? In her presentation this afternoon, our distinguished guest Kamila Shamsie addresses questions like these in this year's Rose Wohlgemuth Weisman Women's Voices Lecture. Kamila, who makes her home in London, is nonetheless no stranger to our community at Case Western Reserve University. She is the author of 6 novels, by my count, which have been widely recognized with awards such as the Prime Minister's Award for Literature from the Pakistan Academy of Letters and the Danish Literature Prize. In 2010, she received an Annisfield Wolf Book Award here in Cleveland for her 5th novel, Burnt Shadows, a story of love and war spanning 3 generations and taking us from Nagasaki in 1945 to colonial India and New York City in the aftermath of the attacks of 9/11. Her most recent novel, A God in Every Stone, likewise follows a long historical arc as it tells the story of a young English woman whose passion for archaeology develops in the shadow of the First World War, taking her from Turkey back to England and finally to Karachi in search of a lost ancient artifact. Kamila Shamsie's stories of love and loss, memory and betrayal help us to contextualize the events of history through the prism of art, precisely the perspective that the countervailing forces of war and destruction seek to deprive us of. The fund that makes this lecture possible was established in 1993 to bring outstanding women authors to the university to deliver a Women's Voices lecture and engage in other activities to stimulate interest in and appreciation of creative writing by women. It is indeed a privilege for us today to listen to Kamila Shamsie's voice on the subject of mourning for lost art. Please join me in welcoming her back to Cleveland.
Thank you, Peter, and thank you to all of you for coming. In December 2014, I was in Antarctica. I like being able to say that casually. And I just want you to know that the weather in Antarctica in December is the same as in Cleveland in April. the fact that December in Antarctica is midsummer should not in any way detract from the full horror of what I'm seeing. But it actually is a beautiful day, and I'm really very pleased to be here. And I'm going to use PowerPoint, which I've never done before. I think as a novelist, I possibly have some kind of competitive attitude that comes from that terrible expression, a picture is worth a thousand words. But notwithstanding that, today I've decided to go for it, because some things you simply have to see. You know, a few days ago I was at a writing retreat in Tuscany, largely cut off from the outside world, surrounded by rolling Tuscan hills and dogs who would visit me in my writing studio, and the kind of well-being that I can only find when I'm able to burrow myself in my writing all day and emerge to good food and conversation before retreating back into solitude once more. I had been there since the beginning of March and was deep enough into the rhythm of my writing life that although I started my days with a glance at the news headlines, very little of world events actually made its way deep into my brain, not even the enthralling matter of your primaries. But that was before I read the news story, which told me that in Syria, government forces were on the verge of reclaiming Palmyra from the forces of Daesh, or whatever else you want to call them, ISIS, ISIL, Islamic State. I like to use Daesh ever since, which is the term popular in the Arabic world, ever since I heard it's actually a crime to refer to them by that term in the territory they control. So I'm going to use Daesh. So here I'm in Tuscany, and at lunch I mentioned the news about the Syrian military advances to my friend and host, 90 years old, who had visited Palmyra just a few years earlier. "Too late," she said. I knew exactly what she meant because I had had the same thought. Too late to mention the wondrous Temple of Bel, which Peter just talked about so beautifully, which Daesh first desecrated by turning it into a site for public execution and then destroyed. Here it is, by the way. That's what they destroyed. That's the great threat, right? Its architecture is a mix of different influences, Greco-Roman and Near Eastern both, or as we might term it in the far too crude system of classification we like to use, East and West. In 32 AD, it was dedicated to the Mesopotamian god Bel, who's often identified with the Greek god Zeus and the Roman Jupiter. During the Byzantine era, the temple was converted into a Christian church. In the 12th century, the Arabs further converted it into a mosque. This is part of its history, I think, which we aren't told often enough. The way people of different faiths worshipped here over the centuries, there was very little in some ways to bring these people together, but what did bring them together was they all arrived at this temple and thought, we want that to be part of our belief system. So back to Tuscany in the news headlines. A few days later, when the Syrian government had, as anticipated, retaken the city, the news that emerged was better than expected. Although the Temple of Bel had been destroyed along with other ancient sites, some 80% of the archaeological sites and artifacts in Palmyra remained intact. Cause for rejoicing, of course, but I remained discomforted by some of the ways in which it was getting talked about. So for example, the UK newspaper, The Guardian, which is one I subscribe to and often write for, wrote this in its news story, and I quote, "After driving ISIS out of Palmyra's old city, Syrian soldiers, pro-government militiamen, and Russian fighters strolled among the ruins in awe, amazed that they were still intact. They walked slowly in fear of roadside bombs or hidden mines that ISIS may have left behind. But the joy and relief was palpable. But one Syrian fighter stood sobbing loudly in the old ruins. I'm sad to see some of the old city destroyed, but I'm also weeping for my brother who died in the battle here," he said. Now, you might think that what discomforted me was the fact that I had been cheering over the preservation of old buildings when there has been a real and terrible human cost in Palmyra during the Syrian Civil War. But actually, no. That didn't discomfort me. That doesn't discomfort me at all. I don't mean there hasn't been a human cost or that it doesn't matter. I start by thinking of Khaled al-Assad, an archaeologist and historian and keeper of Palmyra's archaeological heritage. He was the father of 11 children, including a daughter who he named Zenobia after the famous queen of Palmyra. Some reports said he was murdered for refusing to tell Daesh where certain artifacts had been hidden to keep them safe. Others suggested his killing simply could have been tied to a pattern of murdered intellectuals. When I say I'm not discomforted by thinking about the loss of artifacts rather than lives, what I'm really saying is that no one should suggest that there is a way of weighing up the death of Khaled al-Assad against the destruction of the Temple of Bel and deciding which was worse. There is no equation for calculating the value of life against the value of 2,000-year-old ruins. The two acts of decimation cannot and should not be seen in opposition to each other, but as part of the same continuum of inhumanity. Or to put it another way, if you encounter someone who is going to dynamite a 2,000-year-old temple because they find it offensive, you can be pretty sure they've killed some people on their way there. Before I talk about what made me uncomfortable in the reporting about the recapture of Palmyra, allow me a slight preamble via this question. Why did Daesh destroy the Temple of Bel? There's an easy answer. Because their version of Islam destroys anything that doesn't fit into their bloodthirsty, punitive worldview. I'm not about to deny that their worldview is bloodthirsty and punitive, though as a Muslim, I would preface that with perversion of Islam rather than version of Islam, but that's a conversation for another time. The point to be made here is that the 80% of the ruins that remain in good shape in Palmyra suggest there wasn't an overriding zeal about destroying the ancient artifacts. Even more pertinently, numerous sources say that rather than routinely destroying antiquities, Daesh makes a tidy sum of money from the business of selling them. That does appear to be why they wanted Dr. Al-Assad to tell them where those artifacts were, so they could sell them and make a lot of money. And, you know, it's an interesting point, those people out there in the world who are buying the artifacts. Are they saving history, or are they funding the people who destroy the Temple of Bel? I would say the latter, in fact. I think there's a point where you don't go out and save an artifact because the cost is too high. But I don't know, if someone handed me something 3,000-year-old and said, you can save this, I'm not sure what I would do. You know, if you start reading up on Daesh by those who closely follow and research their actions, you very quickly encounter the word propaganda. Daesh invests a great deal of time and money into propaganda and are horrifyingly good at it. They want media attention. They want airtime. They want to outperform Al-Qaeda. Let's not forget that their primary enemy isn't the Syrian government or the Western world. It's the rival jihadi group in Syria. Al-Nusra, which is a branch of Al-Qaeda. Daesh wants anyone sympathetic to radical, militant Islam to think, of all the jihadi groups in the world, these guys are the one on top. They're the ones to join. And it's not just fighters they're appealing to. Their establishment of a state, or a caliphate as they like to call it, means they want to run a state for which they need doctors, engineers, media specialists, etc. The more the locals who they're ruling over flee from them, the more they need people coming in. And in fact, this has been one of their big problems in recent years. They've been putting out appeals, for instance, for doctors to come because they don't have enough. So yes, proving themselves to be the number one jihadi outfit out there is a very important objective for Daesh, and they can't achieve it if people stop talking about them. After a point, the outside world stops being interested in the stories of human victims. But dynamite a 2,000-year-old structure, and you're back in the headlines. Of course, it's not all about recruitment. They also want anyone who might resist them to be terrified into submission. They want their impunity to be broadcast. What better way to do that than to destroy a monument beloved all over the world? And of course, that raises another difficult question, which is when they do a thing like that, should the world be reporting on it or not? How can you not report on it when they destroy something like this? But how can you report on it when you know that what they want is attention? I have an answer to that. But Daesh isn't the only murderous group in Syria involved in PR and benefiting from media attention. Here we return to my discomfort. Consider again that Guardian report on the recapture of Palmyra. After driving ISIS out of Palmyra's old city, Syrian soldiers, pro-government militiamen, and Russian fighters strolled among the ruins in awe, amazed that they were still intact. They walked slowly in fear of roadside bombs or hidden mines that ISIS may have left behind, but their joy and relief was palpable. Look, it's the good guys, right? Except it's not. The horrors that the Syrian President Bashar al-Assad unleashed on his civilian population are unmatched in scale by any other group in Syria's civil war, including Daesh. Many estimates put at 250,000 the number of those killed by his forces. Now, those figures are contested, but you also have the images smuggled out of Syria by the photographer Cesar, which reveal almost unimaginably barbaric torture conducted by Assad's governments on its opponents. Now, I've chosen not to show those pictures on the basis of my belief that the dead have the right to not become a spectacle, but take my word, they are the stuff of nightmares. Cesar photographed over 6,000 tortured corpses over a period of 27 months at two military hospitals in Damascus, where the bodies of those who died in prison were processed. Let me repeat that. In just over 2 years, the government tortured to death over 6,000 people just in the city of Damascus. The primary difference between Assad and Daesh is that Daesh wants the world to know of its crimes against humanity as part of their shock tactics, while Assad wants to hide them as part of his attempt to project an image of himself as the civilized alternative in Syria. So when we are given images of Assad soldiers walking through the streets of Palmyra with their palpable joy at finding ruins still standing, and when we move from that to the image of the solitary soldier weeping for his brother who was killed in the fighting, it's very hard to remember that these are the forces of barbarity too. I'm not suggesting that the soldier's grief wasn't genuine, or that his brother's death should be viewed with delight or even indifference. And I'm not suggesting that government soldiers weren't awed by the ruins of Palmyra. But it remains troubling that the overall tone of that article was one that told us to place our sympathies with the forces of Bashar al-Assad and to be grateful for their victory. A quick reminder of the political moment in which Palmyra was retaken by the Syrian government. There's a ceasefire in place between all the various forces fighting in Syria, except for Daesh and al-Nusra, which, as I mentioned, is al-Qaeda, a branch of al-Qaeda. Assad, backed by the Russians, is using the ceasefire to win back territory he's lost to Daesh. The more territory he captures, the more difficult it becomes to exclude him from any peace negotiations, even though all Syrian opposition groups argue that any post-war settlement cannot include him. And so I'm discomforted, and beyond that, I'm angered that the wondrous ruins of Palmyra should be used as part of a propaganda effort to make Assad look palatable to the world. Assad himself is well aware of how useful it might be to present himself as a man of culture. Last Wednesday, he called on the United Nations and other international organizations to help his government restore Palmyra to its former glory. In the same message, this leader, who has used nerve gas against his own citizens, also said, "And this moment might be the most effective to accelerate the collective war on terrorism." All this is to say, when we celebrate the ruins that are still standing, when we imagine the work of restoration that will place ancient heads back onto the shoulders that bore them for 2,000 years, we need to also be on guard for the ways in which our joy can be exploited for someone else's propaganda purposes. It is worth, instead, tracing our joy back to its source to ask ourselves the question, what is it I celebrate when I celebrate ancient artifacts withstanding savagery? For me, the question leads back to Pakistan, the country in which I was born and raised. Although I no longer live there, I spend my winters in Karachi, where my parents and sisters still live, and it was there, in Karachi, that I was promoting a novel I had written in the early months of 2009. My novel, Burnt Shadows, started with the bombing of Nagasaki in 1945, and I was invited onto a talk show to discuss it. The other guest on the show was a political analyst who was there to talk about recent violence in the city of Peshawar, which was at the time often under attack as the capital of the province or state, where the Taliban had at the time captured a sizable portion of territory. During a commercial break, when the cameras had turned off, the host turned to me and said, offhand, "Look, you've written a book about a bomb in Nagasaki in 1945, and here we have bombs going off in Peshawar today." What struck me then was that as a consequence of all the research I had done for the novel, I had a much clearer sense of Nagasaki, a city that I had never visited, than I did of Peshawar, also a city that I had never visited, but one that was part of the same country in which I had grown up. Peshawar, situated near the border with Afghanistan at the foot of the Khyber Pass, can seem a distant place even if you've grown up in Karachi. When I tried to think of that city, all that came to mind was stories of bomb blasts and a growing Taliban influence. It seemed to me I was allowing a kind of propaganda victory to the Taliban in reducing that city primarily to their actions and their influence, and to have very little sense of everything in Peshawar that stood in opposition to their narrow-minded, small-hearted version of the world. I made a small mental note to do something about that, and then I moved on to the next interview and didn't think very much about it until a few days later, when I read a newspaper report about discussions underway on how to protect the world's largest Gandhara collection in the Peshawar Museum against the Taliban if they should try to target it. Gandhara, for those who don't know it, was the ancient name of a kingdom that for many years had Peshawar as its capital. One of the great centers of Buddhism, Gandhara is now best remembered by its extraordinary art, a fusion of Greek, Persian, Syrian, and Indian influences that developed between the 1st century BC and the 5th century AD. And when I say Syrian, I specifically mean Palmyra. In fact, in 1954, the Yale University Art Gallery had an exhibition entitled Palmyran and Gandharan Sculpture, which specifically looked at the cultural interrelation of those two great ancient places. When I read that newspaper article about the museum and the Gandhara collection, I knew that I had finally found a way into imagining and discovering Peshawar, a way that didn't ignore the contemporary history, but found a way to think about it in terms other than paralytic terror or hopelessness. Some of you may already know the city of Peshawar, either as a place of study or a place you visited. I hope what comes next in this talk will feel like a welcome return to a city that has many reasons to be celebrated. There are others of you who know it as I used to, from news stories. I'm going to try to take you on a journey that in some way follows one that I went on, and through which I learned to crystallize my until then half-formed ideas on why ancient art matters so much. The mention of Peshawar may have led some people in here to think of the Taliban's attack on a school there in December 2014, during which they massacred 144 people, the vast majority of whom were schoolchildren between the ages of 12 and 16. That isn't a story that should ever be forgotten, but it makes it even more urgent that the name of Peshawar should not be primarily associated with the Taliban and their atrocities, just as Palmyra should be thought of in terms other than a stage for a battle between one horror and the other. The first thing terrorists seek to do is to control our imaginations, so let's not allow them to do that. So here we go. I would like to take you all to the northwest of Pakistan, near the entrance of the Khyber Pass, which links Pakistan to Afghanistan, to the city of Peshawar. We start in the old city. For centuries, the old city was surrounded by a wall with 14 gates built into them. In the mid-20th century, to contend with increased road traffic, much of the wall was knocked down, but some parts of it still remain, as do some of the old gates. At any rate, even without the walls, you know you're in a different part of the town as soon as you enter the crowded, labyrinthine streets. The main street of the old city is known as Qissa Khwani Bazaar, or the Storyteller's Market, or the Street of Storytellers. It's a name that dates back to a time before live streaming, before DVDs, before TV, before radio, when the primary form of entertainment in the city came from the storytellers lined up in stalls along the street, each performing badalas, or epic stories in rhyme, for their listening audiences. And this is not easy to see because it's small, so I'm going to go over. And basically what you have there is you have a little stall and men sitting on it, and those are the storytellers, and you have two people sitting on a rope bed outside listening to them. And you'd go along the street and they would all be sort of saying, you know, well, I can tell you, you know, Leila Majnu, I can tell you the battle against the British, I can tell you whatever, and they'd be competing for your attention in that way. And they'd be telling these stories in rhyme, but they'd also be sort of extemporizing during the performances, so they were different every time, and they'd be, you know, in their rhyming couplets, they would start incorporating what was going around them at the moment or make a reference to someone looking bored in the audience. So they were very alive kind of events. This is a postcard of the Street of Storytellers around the time. And I want you to look, if you can see, I'm not sure how clear it is, but you've got basically what you have is shops on the lower ground. On the ground level, there are shops. And above them, you have homes made of wood and brick and mud. And here's what it looks like today. And it's changed in many ways, but you still have shops on the ground floor and homes overhead made of wood and brick and mud. And this was taken while I was in a car, so you can see actually those lines at the back of a car window. But we're passing by these beautiful arched wooden buildings. And there again, at the top there, you can see those very old homes, and at the bottom they're selling all kinds of things like service shoes and marhaba uniform specialist. And that's one more as well. Again, that top balcony from which people would have stood and looked down onto the Street of Storytellers. From the Storytellers Market, you wind your way through narrow streets, pausing at a rich merchant's home from the early 20th century, which is undergoing restoration. It's about three stories high, and again, these beautiful wooden latticed windows inside it. That's a nice piece of stained glass there, as we're here with the Tiffany stained glass. A very short walk from the merchant's house, you come to a 17th century Mughal gateway that will lead you, and that's again, of course, a busy street, but that's the Mughal gateway beyond that, which will lead you into a compound known as Gurkhatri. There's a great deal to see here. There's a very old Hindu temple. There's a British fire engine station. That's my sister enjoying herself sitting on the British fire engine. There's a museum with different artifacts. I just like the door of the museum. In the museum, you'll find many things, but one of the things that entertained me most was this drawing, which is of an Italian general called Avitable. And it's part of the rich sort of stories you find in Peshawar. He was an Italian mercenary. And in one of Peshawar's unexpected stories, he became the governor of Peshawar in 1834 during the rule of the Sikh Maharaja Ranjit Singh. And he was famous particularly for throwing troublemakers off the minarets of the Mohabbat Khan Mosque. As a way of terrifying the locals into good behavior. And people who believe in, you know, the strong, hard man, they always sort of invoke Avitable and say, well, you know, but he was quite good at making the streets nicer, which apparently he was. But anyway, even this, and he's entered local folklore, and he's known as Abu Tabela. And if you want to terrify your children, you'll tell them that Avitable or Abu Tabela will come and get you in the night. But even this surprising Italian is eclipsed by something that at first sight may just appear to be a deep pit. It is instead, I hope you'll enjoy this, Peter, the world's deepest archaeological excavation trench, which was dug in 2007 to see all the layers of Peshawar's history. There are steps cut into the mud walls of the trench, and it's advisable to walk down them with a guide, or you won't understand the full wonder of what you're doing, which is nothing less than walking down 2,500 years of history. It is one of the most spine-tingling things I have ever done. It doesn't look it, but believe me, once you know what's happening, it is. And if you have a guide, as I had this gentleman who's a local archaeologist working on the side, as you walk down, he's pointing to the walls and things that are built into them, like this part of an old house or construction. And he's pointing to these different strata in the soil, and he's saying, that's the British, that's the Sikhs, that's the Mughals, that's the White Huns, that's the Kushans, that's the Scythopathians, the Indo-Greeks, the Greeks, the Persians. The lower strata dates back to the 6th century BC, the time of the Persian Empire. Peshawar has been inhabited continuously since then, making it South Asia's oldest continually inhabited city. And the trench might yet go deeper. Lack of funds put a stop to the excavation, which has yet to resume, which may tell you something about the priority given to history by the local government. Anyway, from the compound of Gorkhatri, we leave the old city and wind back to a part of town built by the British when they ruled here, where we can find the Peshawar Museum, built in 1906 and home to the world's largest Gandhara collection. There's my sister again at the bottom of the frame. And the woman next, so that's me, and next to me is the woman who was showing me around, who's an archaeologist, a fantastic woman called Dr. Meher Taba, who's from Peshawar, and who I was lucky enough to get as my guide. And, you know, we all walk into places with our own stereotypes. If you're from Karachi, you very much have your stereotypes of Peshawar and its social conservatism. So even I was surprised to find a young woman archaeologist. And I said, so do you just go off on sites and do digs and things? And she said, yeah. I said, okay. And it was fantastic because everywhere we walked, her colleagues were working in all the excavation sites, and we just got the most fantastic welcome because I was with her. Anyway, so now if you're going to allow me a moment of self-indulgence, I'm going to ask you to listen to parts of an audiobook as we walk around the museum together. The book is a novel. Its title is A God in Every Stone. It's the book I ended up writing, which was set largely in Peshawar in the early 20th century. And because two of its main characters are archaeologists, several scenes are set in the museum. So what you're going to hear now is fiction, but every artifact I describe really does belong to the Peshawar Museum. The photographs are all mine except for two that I've taken from Wikimedia Commons. One is of the goddess Hariti and her consort, which is now in the British Museum collection, and the other, and that's going to be the first image you're going to see after this, is in the Arthur Sackler Gallery in DC. And it's very similar to one described in the handbook of the Peshawar Museum, but I just, you know, was too busy being awed at what I was seeing to take photographs of everything. But anyway, if any of you are in DC, maybe you'll want to go, after you've seen this image, to the Arthur Sackler Gallery to have a look at it. So anyway, audiobook time. Here you are, walking through the Peshawar Museum, accompanying an English woman called Viv Spencer. She's 21 years old, she's an archaeologist, and she's there with a young 11-year-old boy from Peshawar called Najib. The year is 1915. If she leaned in just a few inches and placed her mouth against the Cupid's bow, she might feel blood flow beneath the stone surface of the lips. But what would he want with her kiss, this man who walked away from his life the day his son was born and became the enlightened one? Viv touched the face, the gray stone cool against her palm, the surface smooth except where a spade had left its mark against the forehead, just centimeters from the raised mole which marked the urna. She touched the scar now in apology for the crimes of excavation. Her fingers traced the grooves between the tendrils of hair snaking towards the top knot. When she had first seen a Gandhara Buddha at the British Museum, she had thought of the hair as Mediterranean, but no longer. She looked over to Najib and his similar hair. The boy was standing next to the web-fingered, larger-than-life Buddhas with their beautiful drapery, which one of the guards claimed to have seen stir in the breeze. As she watched, Najib said something to the guard, who crouched down and lifted the boy up onto his shoulders. "Look, Miss Spencer, He had spotted and been struck by the faint, unexpected pupil. One round of the museum, and he'd already worked out that was unusual. For a long time, he remained motionless, studying it, until Viv clapped her hands twice and Najib dropped off the guard's shoulder, agile, unconcerned by the possibility of hurt. Viv's hand on his elbow, they walked around the high-ceilinged, whitewashed halls of the Peshawar Museum. And this time, instead of rushing from display to display, he asked her to explain those things which had particularly caught his attention. "This is all from here," Najib kept repeating. "This also? This also?" "Yes, all of it. We've left it here instead of taking it back to London so you can see your own history." They walked all along the galleries until they had circled round to the case which displayed excavations at Shaji Kidheri and Takht-e-Bahi. Here, a fragmented, starving Buddha. There, the goddess Hariti holding a cornucopia in one hand, the palm of the other resting on the upper thigh of her consort. And most prominently positioned of all, a casket. On its lid, the figure of the Buddha seated on lotus leaves, flanked by the Hindu gods Indra and Brahma. Along the rim of the lid, wild geese were in flight, and beneath stood the king, Kanishka himself, in his great boots and cloak. And that old familiar form of Eros dropped a garland all around the casket. Viv pointed out the different figures to Najib and explained the word syncretic. I don't know how easy it is to see Kanishka here. I'm going to walk over and point him to you. Right at the bottom, he's a figure in very large boots. And this casket actually forms a big part of the novel that I was writing. But when I went to the Peshawar Museum, I saw it and I was delighted. And then the keeper of the museum, who was a fantastic man, whose father had been the curator and he grew up in the Peshawar Museum and then himself wanted to carry on working there. And he said, "Oh, it's not the original." And I said, "Why isn't the original?" And he said, "Well, the original is in the vaults of the state bank." So sadly, that's what happens with some valuable objects. But now we're going to jump to another point in the audiobooks. Most of the things in the museum are original, I should say, just one or two things in there that aren't. Now you're going to jump to another point in the audiobook. So the young boy, Najib, who I mentioned, he's come back to the museum, and he's brought along his older brother, Qayyum, who has just returned from the Western Front, where he was a soldier in the British Indian Army. Again, this is a story not many people know, but in the First World War, 500,000 Indian soldiers were part of the British Indian Army and fought on the Western and Eastern Fronts. So my character, Qayyum, is one of those soldiers who fought at the Western Front and lost an eye and then was discharged and came home. He's also recently lost his best friend, Kalam, who was a soldier with him. Qayyum's never been to the museum before. He doesn't approve of his brother's enthusiasm for something he sees as belonging to sort of British colonial Peshawar rather than the part of Peshawar, the old city, the walled city, which they've grown up in. But here he is walking around the museum, looking for the first time at these objects. Men and winged creatures and a bird head with human expression, and faces which came from the streets of Peshawar, and other faces which were from somewhere else. There was beauty here, he could see, but it was a beauty that asked to be admired, still and distant, and nothing to do with the world outside. Live among these objects, and your heart would turn to stone. He was thinking this, aware that he was building up an argument, when he stopped in front of a bearded man, sitting down, with his knee drawn up against his chest, his hand clasping the back of his own head in despair. Qayyum heard his breath change and become a noise in his throat. A second figure, its face missing so it was impossible to know if it was a man or a woman, curled the fingers of one hand around the man's upper arm and rested the other hand on his chest. In the angle of the bearded man's head, turned to one side, away from the embracing figure, the sculptor told the world about the impossibility of comfort when loss pierces the heart. Qayyum covered the lower half of his face with the palm of his hand and watched his own grief, felt the awful aloneness of it. A hand slipped into his, and Najib pulled him away from the broken statue and said, this is what you must see, and took him back to the main hall, empty now, and said, here, the Buddha. This is him. The folds of the prophet's skin suggested the former sleekness of the prince he had been. The sunken eyes bore knowledge of all the world's sorrow, all you have endured, all you must yet endure. Qayyum rested his hand against the glass-fronted cabinet and leaned in towards the Buddha's starving face, suspended over the ridged stone of the skin of his chest. Stone made flesh. No, stone made bone and skin. If a man rested his hands on that cage, he might hear a heart beating within. But gently, gently, the ribs could snap from the pressure of a single figure. He shivered and stepped back. Now he understood idolatry. He whispered, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, and the Buddha continued to gaze beyond him, all of the Western Front there in his eyes, every dead soldier, and Kalam Khan bleeding to death, golden alone. So that's the end of the audiobook part of it. When I visited the Peshawar Museum, I was in something close to a state of rapture at all the things I've seen. But of all the artifacts, the one that struck me most was the starving Buddha. I should say this image here of the head suspended over the body is one I had to get off the internet because the display has now been changed so that the head is resting at a level you can see, which is a wise and humane decision because it allows you to look into the Buddha's eyes. Here's something I wrote about the statue for the New York Times. The thin lips appear parched, a fold of skin creases the face, and when you lean in towards the deep hollow of the eyes, the Buddha's pupils fix on you with an expression of such suffering you can't hold the gaze for very long. Some days, some years, it's hard to think of a more apt symbol for Pakistan than this 1800-year-old sculpture of beauty and pain. What do we celebrate when we celebrate ancient artifacts withstanding savagery? We celebrate the mere fact of endurance, to begin with. We celebrate humanity's search for beauty in every age and every corner of the globe. We celebrate the expansion of our own ways of seeing, the deepening of our understanding of beauty and art. We celebrate the dedication of artists and artisans. We celebrate the work of those who preserve rather than destroy. We celebrate human curiosity. To walk around the Peshawar Museum in a time when Pakistan is one of the epicenters of the battle within Islam, which has been raging through this millennium, is to be reminded that there are two stories that we can tell ourselves about the interactions of different cultures and nations and belief systems. One story is the story of conquest and destruction. The other is the story of exchange and deepening knowledge. Both stories are true. But we get to choose which one we have as our particular worldview, which one we bear in mind when we consider if we want to build walls or doorways leading between our homes, our nations, and the outside world. When we celebrate the preservation of ancient art, we must celebrate and profoundly believe in the story of exchange over the story of destruction, and we must then bring that story up to the present moment. This leads me to one further thought, the most difficult of all to unpick. To whom does an artifact belong? To the world or to a particular nation? If I want to make claims for interchange and a porosity of borders, then of course I must say the world. When I have stood before the ancient Roman temples at Baalbek in Lebanon, or when I have stood before a 5,000-year-old cave painting in the foothills of the Cedarberg in South Africa, or when I've stood before the great mosque of Cordoba in Spain, which is now the Cathedral of Our Lady of the Assumption, I have never felt foreign in my relationship to those works of human hands and human imagination. And yet. My journey to Peshawar and its past started with a newspaper article considering what to do to protect ancient, invaluable artifacts from people who might wish to destroy them. There is an argument, I've heard it made, for shipping them out to friendly museums somewhere else in the world that would be glad to have them, to protect them until the world is made safer. I could not disagree more with those arguments. The world's great artifacts do belong to the world, and so, of course, the world should, when it's able, come to see them in Tuscany, Peshawar, or Palmyra. But to take them out of the place for which they were created is to make them contextless. And further, it is to deprive the people who have lived in a land from knowing the possibilities and history that arose from that land. This February at the Lahore Literature Festival, I asked the Egyptian writer Ahdaf Soueif what it means to live in a country with a rich awareness of its historical past as opposed to one that forgets or disregards what came before. It's the difference between being a memory and having amnesia, she said. She's right. In the country I come from, there are men, some women too, who try to tell the nation that it should be, it must be, one particular way. They want a narrow vision, a stony heart, an attack on pluralism to define who we are. They do a good job of convincing the amnesiacs. But there are others who grew up knowing that we come from a place where miniature stupas give us the Greek hero Atlas bearing the Buddha aloft on his shoulders. This is one of the great images repeated over and over again in Gandhara art. That is Atlas, the Greek Atlas, although his pose is more Indian than Greek, you might see. And in a lot of the, this is from a partially broken statue, but if you see miniature stupas, if you see the intact statues, it's always Atlas there and he's holding up the Buddha. And that is Gandhara for me, that single image. If you remove artifacts and objects that tell the people of a nation, this happened here, this is who you are, this is the tradition to which you belong, that to me is a capitulation to the forces that want to make us amnesiacs. It is, in effect, doing the Taliban's work for them. Among the people who grew up with a memory rather than amnesia were the Nobel laureate Malala Yousafzai and her father Ziauddin. In her book, I Am Malala, she talks about growing up in the Swat Valley, part of the ancient region of Gandhara, before the years when she became famous as the girl who stood up for education, the girl who was shot by the Taliban. She speaks of the ancient Buddhas carved into the rocks beside which her family would picnic and of playing hide and seek in the ancient ruins of temples. Her father Ziauddin, she tells us, once wrote a poem that brought together the traditions of Islam and Buddhism that are woven into the air of the Swat Valley. And here's his short, lovely poem. When the voice of truth rises from the minarets, the Buddha smiles and the broken chain of history reconnects. Let me do that again. When the voice of truth rises from the minarets, the Buddha smiles and the broken chain of history reconnects. Reconnecting the broken chain of history, that's a lesson for our time, for every time. If you want to understand the moment you're in, trace history back and further back and further back. Later in the book, when Malala mentions the Taliban coming to the Swat Valley for the first time, she writes, "We were not fans of the Taliban, as we heard they destroyed girls' schools and blew up giant Buddhas. We had many Buddhas of our own that we were very proud of." You'll notice that the blowing up of giant Buddhas is right there on equal footing with blowing up girls' schools. There is plenty more in the book about the destruction of history being one of the aims and crimes of the Taliban. It goes to follow that getting more people into museums, leading school tours down the world's deepest archaeological excavation trench, and mounting an exhibition that will reveal the cultural connections between Palmyra and Peshawar might be a nice way to counter that fundamentalist, barbaric influence. All this, I suppose, must feel very far from Ohio. But I can't say the word Ohio without being reminded that it is an Iroquoian word. Where we stand now is also a place that was once an old culture that is largely forgotten. America has its own form of amnesia. It's an amnesia that's made easier by the fact that the old culture that was largely eradicated was not a culture that left behind giant monuments that can stand as a daily rebuke and reminder. That old culture didn't have that particular kind of ego. I know the consequences to Pakistan if it forgets the pluralistic culture that has deep roots in its history. What is the consequence to America in forgetting the culture of the Native Americans? It's a question that those of you who live in the state once inhabited by the Kickapoo, the Shawnee, and the Erie tribes, and now with a baseball team called the Cleveland Indians, are surely better positioned to answer than I am. But there's one very obvious consequence of amnesia that strikes an outsider right away. In America and in Ohio, amnesia about the past means forgetting a culture that was profoundly aware of the environment. Consider America's own environmental record, and you might be moved to agree that it's time to bring back some historical memory of this land and its traditions. But it is understandable in many ways that America should choose amnesia about a past that is very long ago and shameful. There's a more recent history, a prouder history, that parts of America also seem intent on erasing. The history of a nation that welcomed migrants and prospered as a result. As someone who was first welcomed to this country 25 years ago as an international student, as a Muslim, as a Pakistani, there is one word I want to leave you with. Remember. Thank you.
Got it. Thank you for that wonderful talk. I'd like to invite questions and comments from the audience. I thought that rather than have you parade up here, I can actually do something useful and bring you the microphone. But first, I wanted to ask a question about the reconstruction of Palmyra. I haven't actually followed this very closely, though, in the first day or two after the news that the city had been retaken by the Syrian army. There was talk about how this might be done and using measurements taken before the occupation and things like 3D printers and so forth and so on. But of course, something like the Temple of Bel, it's been obliterated. It's not fragments and that can be put back together. It's essentially going to be a completely new construction resembling a ruin. Is that an appropriate way to remember?
You know, it's a very good and very difficult question, which is when part of history is about destruction, and we're talking about remembering history, then what do you do with that destruction? It's a very tough one. You know, there's a part of me that hears the 3D imaging stuff and think, well, that's great, but also weird. You know, to have in the middle of Palmyra to enter and have a 3D reconstruction of the Temple of Bel. I don't know. There's a way in which it feels a little like bravado at the moment, so soon after to say, we will reconstruct. No, you won't, actually. You will not be reconstructing it. It won't be the 2,000-year-old thing. And there's, I think at the moment it's too near, and I think people are jumping in with a lot of, you know, we'll show them, we will, you know, create this thing with our wonderful new technology to show them that they can't destroy it. Well, they can and they have. I think where things, you know, there are, for instance, a lot of statues which are headless, but the heads are still lying there. And those should certainly be reconstructed. You know, I think where, and I think it's a very beautiful and moving thing, the thought of it. But I don't know about the Temple of Bel. I know they're doing a reconstruction which they're going to bring to New York. And you think, well, okay, you know, certainly have... I'll tell you what you really need. What you really need to do is to look at what Palmyra was before, because, you know, we talk a lot of the destruction that Daesh has done, but there's a UNESCO report on the destruction between 2012 and 2015, which is before Daesh took the city, and it's a destruction by Assad's forces when, you know, they were sort of preparing it as a battleground and, you know, doing all kinds of hideous things. And there are other descriptions of it a few years earlier. There's an architect in Homs whose name I've forgotten, shamefully, a woman who's just written a book about growing up there. And she says, well, actually, if you went Palmyra, you know, just before all this happened, you'd have seen all kinds of neglect. And that's the part of the story we aren't talking about. And I think really the important thing is to have a conversation that says those sites that still exist and those artifacts that still exist, you need to make sure those are better looked after. And that's the main work. And other than that, I would say let the experts go in. You know, I mean, they literally just gone in a few days ago. Let them go in and tell us what can be reconstructed properly, what help they need, what finances they need. But let's not be giving money to Bashar al-Assad's government to do it. So for the moment, I would say let's hold off. You know, I think a thing that's been there 2,000 years, what it teaches us is a little bit of patience is fine.
How would you rewrite the Guardian story that you started off with?
Well, the Guardian did, it has to be said, a couple of days later, have a story in there from a Syrian. To say, to make the point that I'm making, which is let's not do this as a propaganda route. So I think I would do the story as, I would start off probably by talking about that UNESCO report on the damage done by Assad's forces and say, and then this worse damage was done, but to put it forward in the way that doesn't, you know, make one side out to be heroic in the capture. But I think I would also try and highlight a detail which has come out recently, which I find very moving, which is, it's around this question of why is it that they didn't destroy more? And there are some voices coming back and saying, because the locals were getting very upset about it. Now, we don't think of Daesh as a force that worries at all about the locals, but we have to also remember, they are a colonizing, occupying force. And as far as possible, and they're fighting on many fronts, so as far as possible, colonizing occupying forces, if there are certain ways in which they can not rile people up more, you know, they or if they want to sort of pretend, okay, we're doing this nice thing for you, you know, like us more, they do it. And the people of Palmyra, I'm told, said, please don't destroy any more of our ancient artifacts. And I think that's that kind of story, to me, is more of a story than the Russian militiamen who are walking through saying, wow, isn't this great?
Yeah. I thought that the terrorist attacks on Palmyra were more related to attacking the culture and demoralizing the citizens at the same time that they were able to get publicity.
I think that was certainly part of it as well. As I said, that there's, you know, it's also about, and I mentioned this in my talk, it's also about saying we have impunity, we can do anything. Don't try and take us on because we can destroy what has stood for 2,000 years, we can destroy what is valuable to the world. So there was certainly an element, I mean, there's not only one reason for doing it, but absolutely, I think part of what they do is to try and terrorize and to capture the imagination. But it should also be, you know, remembered how much they don't destroy. So it makes you think that the publicity angle, the let's get onto the news headlines, I would guess, and this is my guess from having read extensively various reports on Daesh, but it seems that their propaganda is sort of overwhelmingly of importance to them. So I would put that as the first reason, probably, which is why, you know, they end up destroying the biggest temple of all.
Yeah. Other questions? Comments? Yes?
Has anyone here been to Valmiera? No.
I was wondering, as an author, when you're connecting to these stories, do you walk away from it more with a feeling of hope or of despair?
It's interesting, you know, generally speaking, these days and for a while now, I'm fairly despairing of the world we're in. But when I write fiction, I can't do that through despair. It's not a mood through which the writing happens, possibly because the act of writing itself is the least despairing thing I do. I don't feel great about the world we're in right now. I think it's pretty terrifying. I think we've reached such stages of polarization and sort of siege mentality, and in different parts of the world have allowed our brains to be colonized by fear. And it's not, you know, it's very nice to blame terrorist groups, but it's very often our own governments who do it. I live in Britain, which is one of the most biggest surveillance societies. And there are all kinds of laws that have been enacted there in the last few years, much like post 9/11 here, which are completely eroding civil liberties in all kinds of ways. And the interesting thing in Britain is very often the heads of the intelligence services will say, we don't need these new laws. You know, the laws we have already allow us to do our jobs, but it's the government that is just bringing in more and more laws. And people are afraid. People are allowing themselves to be afraid. And so they think, well, for our own security, we need this measure and this measure and this measure. And they're giving away. And, you know, for someone who has grown up in a military dictatorship, you learn very quickly to recognize which laws are against the people. And when you see a nation that for centuries has built up civil liberties, handing them back as if they don't matter, as if there really is a truth to the idea that civil liberties and safety are in opposition to each other, it's a pretty heartbreaking thing to see.
I wanted to ask you also, you spent some time, obviously, in Peshawar while you were working on your novel. And the photographs you showed us in the museum, and I did indeed appreciate the world's deepest archaeological trench. One thing that struck me is that nobody was there. What is the sort of general awareness and appreciation of the rich and diverse cultural heritage of that place among the people who live there now?
Varied. The museum was fairly empty, and when, you know, I had figures on how many people went to the museum annually in 1915 when Peshawar was, you know, a tenth of the size it is now. More, and I asked the curator, I gave him the figures, and he said, oh, it's less now. In schools, I don't think it's not in the curriculum properly, because the, you know, your conservative governments over the years have tried to do a kind of Islamic history part of things rather than the deeper history. But I think if you go outside Peshawar, I think where you really find people are aware of it more is, for example, as Malala uses, I wrote about, in places like the Swat Valley, where you don't have to go specifically into a museum when going to a museum may not be part of what you do. But there are many parts of the Swat Valley where Buddhas are carved in rock all around. And I think where it's a part of the natural landscape, and where you're going for picnics among them, and, you know, sitting by the river, that there it's slightly deeper. But there is a big problem within Pakistan about telling its own history, and I think that's part of the reason why we've become this nation of amnesiacs, is because the government has not done enough to start talking about this richer and wider heritage.
Other questions, comments? Yes, hold on.
Really struck me when you were talking about this country and Native Americans. And last year, about this time, I was in New York and went to an exhibition at the Metropolitan Museum of Art. And it was a huge exhibition of Plains Indians. Mm-hmm. And it was really amazing. Mm-hmm. I had never seen such a collection of this work. But most of the pieces came from Europe. They were not in this country. And that was a stunning fact to me, that we so discarded and disregarded, you know, our history. And it makes me feel very cynical, really, when I hear these stories and I see these things. It seems to be one horrible facet of the human condition that we are tribal, we are nationalistic, we disregard others in very horrible ways. Anyway.
You know, it seems to me these days that it is a political, a moral, a spiritual project to find ways of optimism. It seems necessary. And I don't always know where to look for it. But it seems increasingly necessary to not buy the notion that we are inevitably a certain way, to say we are inevitably nationalistic or inevitably tribal, and instead just to look and see, how did this happen? Why is this history not here? And then trace it back to certain political decisions that have been made, decisions by the powerful. I think it's an important thing to separate those who have power from those over whom they wield it. I'm extremely cynical about those who have power. I think, you know, that, you know, it's such a trite line now, it seems, because we hear it so much, power corrupts absolutely. But it does seem that power has a deranging effect. If you look at it, what most of Shakespeare is about, right, the derangements of power, or maybe I just read it that way, because, and again, it's to do with growing up with military dictatorships, and to see what that does to people. But I don't think the decisions made by the powerful represent all of humanity, and I don't think we should give them that power to say you represent all of humanity when they are acting in the most cynical ways, when they're acting to further their own particular narrative. And I think what... Now, look, there's Atlas, right? He's in Peshawar. And near him there's a column, and on the column there are acanthus leaves, right? At the top of the red, those leaves that you see. Let's go way back. Here we cycle back through history to make a small point. These are a lot of slides. Ah, there we go. There are the acanthus leaves. So when I mean, little things like that, when I hear that we're tribal and we're narrow-minded, and what I think is artists aren't that. Artists have never believed in that, because art, in fact, says, oh, well, that's a beautiful thing holding up a column. I'll use it here. It doesn't matter that it came from you. I'm not going to say, I need my own leaf. I'm going to say, isn't that wonderful? How can I use it? And someone else will take it from me. And it's not just the artists, it's the people who are viewing it and appreciating it, that there is a different narrative of human interaction. There are stories everywhere of people not being tribal. There are stories everywhere of people welcoming refugees. There are stories everywhere of people welcoming migrants. And we do the world a disservice when we believe that humanity is essentially small-minded. I think it's being driven into that corner by a lot of different forces, but I don't think it is essentially that. I have to believe that, right? Yeah.
Thank you very much for coming. That was really inspiring, and it's an act of resistance, right? We refuse to be colonized in this way by these forces that seek to erase history. So here we are. We're doing good. We're doing something good. So thank you very much for that. My name is John Broich. I'm a British Empire historian in the history department here. And I just want to offer a really quick story that in summer 1941, there was a battle at Palmyra. It was British, Australian, Free French, Indian, and Arab troops mm-hmm. fighting against the Vichy French collaborationists, French Foreign Legion, and Palmyra. And it was a success for the Allies, too. So I just want to offer that story of people coming together to free Palmyra as well in 1941. But thank you very much.
Thank you.
Again, your message is great.
Are there any more questions? Okay, we'll take one more.
How much of it is the insecurity of these people that are, say, Daesh? How much of it is their insecurity? They want to convert you. They want to steal your past, make you forget the past, and nothing before them really ever appeared. I was at the lecture last night about the Armenian genocide, and it was basically looks like it's the same thing. We want to kick the non-believers out, the Christians, the Jews, the Greeks, pick a group, and only our view matters. Thank you.
The powerful tend to be very insecure. It's one of the interesting things. It's also a point to be made about the difference. It's one of the weird fascinations. One of the differences between, or the split between Daesh and Al-Qaeda was that Daesh wanted to be killing other Muslims a lot more. So that, in fact, their primary target is Shias. And Al-Qaeda said, hold off a bit because this is giving us bad PR because there are a lot of Muslims who, you know, would be fine with us killing Americans, say. But don't go killing the Shias. And Daesh said, no, they are the first enemy. They're the worst of all. They're the apostates. They have the narrowest, the idea of them wanting to convert you. I think that, they seem less intent on converting people. They just kill. Right, they're not into the business of conversion. They're not out there proselytizing. They're just saying, either you believe what we believe or we'll go ahead and kill you. They're very narrow and small, really. But they can do tremendous harm, as the narrow and small often can.
Well, I think on that note.
Oh, well, we got one person. Can we just do one more back there? Because she's been,
Hi, I'm Ananya. I also teach in the history department. Hi. And thank you for a very rich talk. Something that Professor Knox brought up, what should be done in Palmyra. What has happened to the Bamiyan Buddhas that were destroyed by the Taliban is UNESCO sort of asked for different designs of architecture. Now it's going to be a community space. It's beautiful, and it opens out to the Bamiyan Valley, but it's something that it's a lived space. So that's one maybe way of approaching it. The second thing is, it was a very rich and thought-provoking talk, but I was wondering, when I believe it's Columbia University Press eventually brought out this collection called The Poetry of the Taliban, to which Faisal Devji, I believe, wrote the introduction. And there was a big controversy about whether a collection like that should be out in the world at all, because we want to make this sort of a binary distinction between kissa, storytelling, and destruction. But what's important, one of the ways in which I think the poetry of the Taliban was justified was that some of these older traditions are actually used and is part of a propaganda. And if you look at them, some of them are actually love poems. So it's actually a messy and complicated thing. Not everyone is the leadership of the Taliban, and there are poor people, so not everyone is powerful. And I believe, I don't know much about ISIS. In ISIS, there must be recruits who are not powerful. So I was just wondering how we could think about a collection like that. Thank you.
I haven't read the poetry of the Taliban, but reading around it and looking at some things, one thing that actually struck me was it seemed that a lot of the poets in there were, we don't know they're Taliban, they're Afghans writing poetry, and it's being marketed as the poetry of the Taliban because that'll sell more. But it it seemed clear, at least from some of the poems I saw, that, you know, that this was a marketing tool, and that was the bit I really objected to, was to sort of lump all these Afghans into, and some of them were sort of Mujahideen. It was Mujahideen poetry pre-Taliban. So I think there's a problem there with this sort of marketing angle as well. But no, I mean, I think you have to be comfortable with the gray areas, right? I mean, we can't say, look, these are the bad guys, so we're not going to allow them poetry, right? Or that, you know, art is not moral, art itself. The bad guys can like poetry. Hitler was a painter, not a very good one, of course, which is important. But you do, of course, want to get a sense of who these people are. The idea that there is a problem, the idea that when you seek to understand a group, you're legitimizing them, is a very strange idea to me. And that seemed to me that is what was behind the idea of criticizing the poetry of the Taliban, that, you know, why are you presenting this nicer face of them? As if somehow, if we read that they wrote poetry, we would think it's okay to destroy the Buddhas of Bamiyan, or it's okay to not let women walk around and go to schools, right? Because that's how stupid we are. And of course, we have the gray areas. And of course, a lot of people who signed up to the Taliban did so because they were farmers or whatever, and they thought, these guys are in power, let me side with them so that they don't come and kill my family, right? There was that aspect of it as well. So of course, you need to see the grayness and the messiness of it all. And, you know, my response to poetry collection is, how good is the poetry? Right?
Well, I think we should thank our speaker one more time.